Hello, I'm John Mann, and I'm standing in the foyer of the State Cinema, Kilburn, London. This was Britain's largest super cinema, and today we're going to show you around this historical building, as well as play you some tunes on the famous Mighty Wurlitzer that is one of the few left in its situation. Let's go. I'm standing here with the chief engineer of the theatre, Mr. Dave Neal. Dave, where are we exactly?
We're in the main entrance foyer, which in 1937, if you were wealthy enough to afford the 1 6 admission fee, you came up this grand marble staircase, entered the Circle Lounge, where you were presented with the choice of either going in to watch the film or show, or you could go into the restaurant to dine. If you were poor, you went round to the Wheels and Lane entrance, where you paid 9 to enter the theatre and went straight into the rear stalls.
Oh, that's where you and I'd have gone, mate. What sort of architecture is this?
The main scheme was Italian Renaissance. Mm. The architect George Coles based the foyer on the entrance to the ballroom in Buckingham Palace.
And this balustrade is real marble?
Real Italian marble imported into the country in 1937 and hand-carved on the premises.
Very beautiful.
It is.
It gives it such an elegant look, doesn't it?
It does indeed.
Let's go through to the lounge then, shall we?
Thank you. Well, John, here we are in the Circle Lounge. In those days when you came in, you first checked your hat and coat in the cloakroom over there. Then you had the choice of either going into the restaurant to eat, or you could make a phone call to tell your wife how late you were going to be, or you could go into the cinema and watch a show.
Oh, let's go and watch the show, shall we?
Here we are in the main auditorium, John. In those days in 1937, the state could hold 4,000 people seated and 4,000 people standing. It also had two projection boxes, which was very unusual, one at the rear of the hall for showing films, one in the centre dome for scenic and special effects.
Oh, wonderful. Well, let's take our seat. The film's just about to start.
Britain's largest super cinema is the Gaumont State at Kilburn, built to provide millions of Londoners and visitors from all over with the last word in luxurious entertainment. It has taken 2 years to build, and 1,000 men have been employed in its construction. The state had the unique distinction of attracting queues many days before the first programme was due to be shown. It is estimated that 250,000 people passed through its doors on a visit of inspection. Thus, they were able to see parts of the cinema which would be closed to them when the show was on. For those of you who were too busy or too lazy to come and look, Gaumont British News now takes you on a tour of the building. Inside the main entrance hall is the First Wonder, a magnificent candelabra, a replica of the electrical fitting in the ballroom at Buckingham Palace. It contains no fewer than 125 lamps. If you like, you can work out how often the manager has to put a shilling in the meter. Leading to the circle is a marble staircase of supreme elegance and beauty. If your neighbour happens to be blushing at this particular moment, it means that he walked up it without wiping his boots. On the way up, you can read the notices on the advertisement boards. The catering side has not been forgotten. A splendid restaurant has been built. Accessible from the theatre, it has its own frontage and entrance. It has a dance floor and is capable of catering for 400 hungry patrons. The theatre is equipped with waiting rooms large enough to hold exactly as many people as the huge auditorium itself. The trouble is they'll probably find people coming to live here. In the foyer there is an iced water fountain. After 8 reels of May West, you can bring your boyfriend here to cool off. The theatre is equipped with telephones, of course, enabling you to explain under ideal conditions that you've been delayed at the office. On the first floor, there is a cloakroom for men, also very necessary. There may be one or two things a man doesn't mind having on his lap, but a thick overcoat isn't any of them. Up in the circle is the control panel, which is actually the nerve centre of the theatre. From here, the manager is able to speak through loudspeakers into every key position in the building. All action is controlled from here. The operating box this film is being projected at this moment is a real mechanical wonder. It is split into two departments, one for film projection, one for scenic and organ effects. There is also a fan for dealing with a certain type of wisecrack. For the artists who come here to entertain you on the stage, there are many dressing rooms. This is one of the larger type, fitted with all the latest devices for making a beauty chorus more beautiful than ever. A shower bath has even been installed. Actors and actresses are usually greatly ill-treated, and it isn't very often they get a shower bath off the stage. For the top liners on the bill, there are luxury dressing rooms. These are big enough to allow the largest prima donna to stun her press agent in comfort. For the first time in cinema history, a special broadcasting studio has been installed. And so this palace of pleasure makes its bow to the world of entertainment. Good luck, Gaumont State. Thank you. first night, the gala premiere, attended by hundreds of notabilities. Here are the brothers Hyams, whose energy and business ability have been so largely responsible for the fulfillment of this greatest theatre project in all Britain. George Formby arrived with his ukulele. The compere of the stage show for the opening night was Vic Oliver. Also in the wonderful stage show was Larry Adler with his harmonica, and that seems to be George Formby again. Last, but by no means least, the incomparable Gracie Fields.
This unique four manual 16 rank organ was first played on the 20th of December 1937 by the legendary organist Sidney Torch. I was involved later in the 1970s when I first played here, and at that time the organ, of course, which used to come up on the lift, wasn't here, it was on the right-hand side of the stage over there.
And of course the organ is a Wurlitzer. Once again, no expense has been spared in this direction. And with Sidney Torch at the keyboard, what more could you desire?
We're underneath the stage here, and it's a bit spooky. But this passage leads to the lift, and I can imagine all the famous organists that at some time or another walk this route to play the organ to us. This is where the famous lift is. There was a story going around about a roll top that used to come over the organ, and then you press the button and the organ was on a carousel, and it used to turn like that before it came into position and up to the height of the stage. And what happened once, that I believe it was Sandy McPherson actually, pushed the button like this, the roll top didn't function, but the organ did, and it started to come up, and he came out in a shower of wood.
Thank you. Now for a peep behind the scenes. This fearsome-looking collection of switches is the stage manager's control board, the most up-to-date in the world. When you see the lights on the stage gradually dim or turn from sunlight to moonlight, it has all been carefully thought out beforehand. If the man at the switch makes a mistake, the entire stage might go black in the middle of a song. The latest type of microphone is installed to ensure that every syllable on the stage is perfectly reproduced in the farthest corners of this huge theatre. This is how the screen is raised for the stage show or lowered again after it. Scenery and curtains are all worked from here. The stage lighting is the most modern in the world, incorporating many devices which are to be found in no other theatre.
Thank you.
thought it was about time that I explained some of the stops on this magnificent Wurlitzer organ. Wonder if you've been woken up on a Sunday morning with a sound like this. This is from what we call the traps, the toy counter department. Sunday morning, Boys Brigade. One of the stops that are on this organ, which is the only one in the country, and that is the harmonic flute. And this is how that sounds. It's a beautiful little stop. Can almost hear James Galway, can't you? One of the interesting stops is the vox humana, the human voice. Although this doesn't sound anything like a human voice, I can assure you. It's more like an old goat, really. But this is the sort of sound it creates. Nice, isn't it? But of course, mixed with the tibia, of course, it sounds beautiful. Lovely, isn't it? One of the American organists, Jesse Crawford, was reputed to be the poet of the organ, and he could reduce his audience to tears through his sympathetic playing. I can do that anyway. They all cry when I play. But one of his little quirks of playing was to use open harmony glissandos, and the way he did it was quite simply on an 8-foot tibia. And what you do is you get, say, a chord of C on an 8-foot tibia, and you take the middle note and put him an octave lower, and then you glide. Like that. I'm going to play you now one of the pieces that he made famous. It's a lovely piece called Somewhere a Voice is Calling. Thank you.
yellow 38. Hold your markers, card 194, you're still red, yellow blue 48. Yellow 38 is your last, your next number. Is yellow 24, blue 58. Blue 48, claim 194, good, blue 9, you take away 2 mega vouchers.
My career spans over a number of years. In fact, I've been called a legend in my own lifetime. But I didn't start on the theatre organ. I actually started as a dancer and then moved into ice skating and then eventually onto the electronic organ, where I played at the sports stadium in Brighton. For 3.5 years I was there. I was inspired by the beautiful organ in the Dome in Brighton. But I learnt my trade on the Odeon Hove Cinema organ, the Wurlitzer of 2-6. And later moved into show business itself, where I presented summer season shows. And then, of course, when that began to fade out, I started on my one-man musical show, which I'm doing at this present time. Of course, in the late 50s, there were lots of lovely musical shows that used to come on tap, things like Sound of Music, and this one that I'm going to play to you now, My Fair Lady.
Thank you.
You know, the last time I played here was in concert, and we had half an hour's music when all of a sudden the organ went dead because the blower had burnt out. So it was decided that 3 months later we would come back and continue the performance. And I think it went down on record as being the longest interval. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the music and this video, and I shall have the pleasure of playing to you again in the not too distant future. But meanwhile, take care. Bye-bye now.